In the upper left-hand corner, we have the option of adding questions. We can add multiple choice, fill in the blank, or numeric. And we're just going to go ahead and build the question list, just like that. Now, I already have a question list created, so I'm not going to go through the process of creating another one. But when we get done creating the question list, we have a save tab in the upper right-hand corner. We want to make sure that we save this question list to a consistent location. Any questions in terms of building a question list? Now, when the students or participants come into your room and you're ready to go ahead and run the presentation, as always, you plug in the receiver, open up the software, and the next thing you'll do is go ahead and load this question list. So I'm going to click my main menu drop-down, come down to question. This time I'm going to load it. Click on the list that I want, and you're going to notice that the first question appears in my floating show bar. Notice below that it still says polling closed, and to the right of it, it reads 1 of 3. That means there's 3 questions in the list. Now, obviously, my students or participants can see the question from here, but that's not going to be good enough, though. We want them to see the question full screen. So as soon as I open up my polling, it's now going to place that floating show bar in the upper right-hand corner, and we'll display the question full screen. As always, my participants would respond to it. I'm going to shut down my polling manually, and I'm going to see my results. Now, we don't have to close this question list in terms of clicking out of this box before we open up polling again. As soon as we open up polling a second time, it automatically goes to the next question in the list. Once again, participants respond. And I want you to be aware, and I want to note, that you can always access this charts button to see the results coming in real time. You can always click this main menu drop-down and put in a countdown timer. And you can always go to view and insert this response in non-response grid. These are always things you can do. It doesn't matter of the environment. These are all items that you can always access. Shut down the polling, get the results as always. Now, when you're 100% done with this question list, another consistent step, and I know I'm a broken record, but that's a good thing because much of these steps are consistent regardless of the environment. You're going to save your results. So you're clicking your main menu drop-down, going to session, and you're going to save the session. Save it to a consistent location. Just go through the Save Session tab to do this. And finally, you're going to go ahead and generate your reports. So go to Reports, under Available Reports. When this time we generate a results by question, since we're using the question list, we're going to be able to see those questions automatically. So this is your third environment where you're using a question list. You build the questions in ahead of time, and then you load them as the participants or students come into the room. How are we doing out there, guys? Are we okay with the 3 different environments, verbal questions, running in conjunction with another application, or using a question list? So now let's go ahead and change gears. And the next thing that I want to talk about is the TurningPoint hardware. So to talk about the TurningPoint hardware, I'm going to go ahead and open up a presentation that's going to display the response cards and also the receiver. Okay, so with the response cards, and we'll go ahead now and we'll close this momentarily, and we'll display this slide full screen. We have 3 basic response cards. Going from left to right, we have the XR response card that allows for fill-in-the-blank short response answers. It also allows for self-paced testing. We have the RF LCD card, which gives you answer confirmation, signal strength, battery life, and also channel confirmation. And we have the standard RF response card, which works identical to the RF LCD, just the exception that you don't have the LCD screen right in the middle. Now, is there anybody in my class today who is going to be using the XR response card and is still a little bit unclear how to actually work through this card? All right, then. We're going to go ahead and talk about the RF LCD and the standard RF response card. The great thing about this hardware is that as soon as Turning Technologies delivers it to you, every single one of these response cards, clickers, whatever you're calling them, including every single receiver, which you see down here at the bottom middle, are all set to the same identical radio frequency channel. Now, what this means, that if you're going to be the only one who is using Turning Point anywhere within a 200-foot range at a given time, this is nothing but a plug-and-play system. The only time that it's not plug-and-play is if somebody else is within 200 feet of you and they're using the same Turning Point channel. If they're using the same channel as you, there's a possibility of getting cross-interference with the signals. In other words, somebody in my room could click a button, and the responses would go to your computer. This is something that we must avoid. So if this is the case, we need to change the channel on both the receiver and each one of these response cards. Now, I'm going to first of all talk about how to change the channel on the response card, and then I'll talk about how to change the channel on the receiver. So with these RF response cards, remember they do function the same way as the RF LCD. The only difference is you don't have the LCD screen right in the middle. These response cards come set automatically to a default channel, and that is channel 41. So as soon as you receive it, it's in your hand, it's already on channel 41. If you need to change the channel to get on a different frequency, you can do this through a three-step process on this response card. To initiate this, we can click the CH button one time in the lower left-hand corner. Our next step is to type out our channel. Our third and final step is to click the CH button again. So it's CH, type out the channel, and then CH. On this standard RF response card, when we do receive a new channel successfully, we have a light in the upper left-hand corner that's going to turn green momentarily and then shut off. This is our indication that the channel change has been successful. We also have a LCD screen right in the middle for those cards, which will give you visual confirmation as to which channel you're currently set to. So they're set to channel 41, but if you need to change the channel because somebody else within 200 feet is also using that same channel, it is done on a three-step process on each individual card. Are there any questions on changing the channel on the response cards? All right, now if I change the channel on my yes, was there a question?
Kevin, yes. Sorry, yes. I have one question. I heard about a new remote that you have coming out that has an alphabet on it, like. True.
We do have a new remote coming out. It's called the Response Card Nxt. That response card NXT is basically going to eventually replace the XR response card that you saw on the left-hand side of that slide. And that response card would allow, you know, the same things as the XR in terms of fill-in-the-blank short response, essay-style questions, and also self-paced testing through the Testing Point software. But it's a lot more intuitive to work through. It's a lot more seamless.
Yeah.
Now, we also have something else called Responseware, where students or participants could use their cell phone to respond to questions, which would also permit fill-in-the-blank and short response, and that's currently out right now.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Now, we're changing channels right now, so I just changed the channel on the response cards. Talked about that. But we must ensure that the receiver is on the same channel as the response cards, because otherwise we won't have any communication between the two. So let's say that my response card was on 41, and I just changed it over to, let's say, 47. Well, look at the channel that my Turning Point Anywhere is currently on. That's channel 45. I now need to change the channel on the receiver to get it on the same channel as the response card. To do this, I'm going to click my main menu drop-down, and I'm going to scroll down to where it reads Tools. From Tools, it gives me a drop-down menu, and I'm going to go all the way down to Settings. In the Settings, where I need to go next is in the upper left-hand corner to where it reads Response Device. So I'll left-click on this. Now I have a new category to the right-hand side called Response Card Channels. Now, since I do have a receiver plugged in, it's registering it with the identification, and also over to the right-hand side, it's displaying what channel it's currently set to. Well, if I know all my response cards have been changed to the 47, I now need to change this receiver to be on the same channel. So I can click the drop-down, and I could change this receiver anywhere between channel 1 all the way down to 82. Since I'm going to 47, that's what I want to click on. Now the channel change will be successful. Keep in mind that the receiver must be plugged in for this channel change to be successful. Click Done. Now my receiver has been changed over to channel 47.